It's one of the founders of our group many years ago tried to, by the way of the books, tried to explain to Commonwealth heads of government, actually, when after about six or seven most incredible smart partnership dialogue interaction and huge tent, where also there were reading tips all over. He was trying to explain what is the core business of this big tent. And he said, well, the core business is to dialogue, to talk round the tables. But it's not just talk, talk, talk. It's a think tanking. That means people are informed. If they're not informed, they will pick one. And our home for that is the CPTM Smart Partners Hub. And they created their home, which is the CPTM Smart Partners Hub, which is not the secretariat of CPTM Limited. That is, by the way, we'll do that as far as we can in the engine and before the AGM comes or things of that nature. But welcome to, therefore, all the smart partners at large. That means the whole network of about 900 or so companions who are people who dedicated a very special effort, and there are quite a number of them here, and fellows who are usually heads of government, or also our chairman is a fellow, or former heads of government for about 20 years, engaged in similar mode, peer-to-peer, like we do it here right now. So they have been invited, they watch, listen online, and connect by email. There are those who are in what we call the more the inclusive initiative focused networks, which emerge. They haven't been set up by anybody. In the middle, and this is a dynamics that try to portray anything in images to make it colorful, show dynamics, show movement, show that it's nothing flat. Or so this is a visioning process. And what it became clear after 20 years or so in various countries, in Malaysia, in Cameroon recently, in Swaziland and so on, in St. Lucia, it became clear that the vision, national visioning, cannot really be simply referred to as a document, which, by the way, could be associated with a national plan, and which is based on statistics, and the reason why we are getting so excited about data and statistics. But because it has networks of central banks dealing with financial inclusion, for instance, and anybody else, mobile banking, everybody else who's involved in that. This is how visions are, visioning is operationalized. So this expresses six inclusion initiatives that emerged up to now, the more recent one, data and statistics. And they are actually this yellow kind of group of people, their names, so that you don't say it's anonymous, their names and their association of being chief executive of Bureau of Standards or Statistics is in the document that you received. And then there are interveners of think tankers in different modules. Some of them are present, some of them are online. Like right now, I want to introduce Dr. Tim Pearson. If we could go, yeah?
Yes, good morning, Michaela.
Good morning, Tim, and I'm sorry that again we rushed to your breakfast in the morning, or you had to be at work a little bit earlier. So Tim is a chief scientist, is not yet chief data scientist, unless you are a chief data scientist now, Tim. Our screen says you are chief data scientist. I thought you were chief scientist. Are you recently a chief data scientist?
No, I'm still the chief scientist, but they let me act as a data scientist right now.
Okay, so anyway, because of that, probably, because we wanted to have one person who know how it looks like as a chief data scientist, you are listed here as chief data scientist. But in fact, Tim has physics as background, nuclear physics, and a number of years ago became the head of the new technology assessment capability in the U.S. government, U.S. Congress. Government Accountability Office. I shouldn't ever say government and Congress. It's quite different. He is always, he was part of our updates, made available updates, technology assessment and processes that are emerging within the governments, so that the science advice goes both into government and parliament or Congress. And also we will have, we don't have yet the picture, but probably we'll find it. We have Robert Hoffman. Robert?
Yes, good morning, Mihaela.
Good morning. It's probably even a bit earlier for you, or the same time in Ottawa with Washington?
Same time.
Same time.
Yes, it is.
Okay, so I think Robert was recruited this morning. It was his night. We did talk before, but he did offer the idea of trying to bring in the experience of the current status of the data and statistics in Canada. When we had this morning, we discussed about science, technology and innovation advice and data. And obviously we were waiting for Tim to more or less finish off that discussion that we had, but also to introduce us to that part of related to data, the data and data and analytics and innovation, which is even more difficult to kind of understand in relation to leveraging the value of data. So, Tim, please come in. And as we discussed, you had some PowerPoints just to make sure that we are we understand this difficult part of data. Do we have the PowerPoints of Tim? Tim's PowerPoints. Okay, so Tim, do you want to come in? I'm going to give you the floor.
Okay, thank you, Mihaela, and good morning. And actually, for me, it's good morning, but good afternoon to all of you in London. I'm sorry I could not be with you personally at this particular meeting, but anyway, it's nice to meet you, at least over the phone. I'm just going to spend a few moments going over some of the key findings from a recent report we did on really what we call DAI, or Data Analytics Innovation. So if you go to slide two, what we're looking at here is just the confluence of several mega trends going on. The first is the data tsunami. We have heard of the various Vs of big data, volume, velocity, variety. There was also visualization and other Vs that come along. But you have the confluence of the large amount of data that has been going out, and as well as the advanced analytical tools that have arisen. And so that has both, like any technology, has a upside and a downside. And so the point of the report that we did for the Congress is to look at the economic opportunities, but also look at the challenges that this new technology trend brings, especially as it relates to not only economic issues, but societal issues. And here in the U.S., certainly in the free world, the idea of individual civil liberties and what that means. So we start with, on slide three, just a schematic of, there's a lot of technologies that have happened, as you all know, in the past 2 to 3 centuries, and you really look at, of course, the Industrial Revolution arising out of the United Kingdom, and then from the in the Cold War era, the rise of the Internet and the revolution there. But you start to see a confluence of those things where we now are merging both the cyber and the physical, and that has profound impact. Let me show you what that looks like. It's slide four. Really is based on these five key trends. The idea of increasingly ubiquitous access. It's difficult now to find a person who does not have a mobile phone, for example. And the expectation that we now have is that we can be on the internet all the time. And moreover, even apart from our own personal devices, we're seeing a lot of public area data collection. I think especially this is true in the UK. There's a good deal of cameras and sensors and things that are there for security reasons and other things. But this is happening also in the United States, so a lot of public area collection, as well as just datification of all kinds of things, from health records, our maps, all kinds of real estate information and so on, as well as just entities putting out open data, and then this other trend called the Internet of Things. These, again, related to the cyber-physical systems, where you now have things, not just computers or laptops or even mobile telephones, you have devices that are Internet-connected. You're seeing a lot of innovation in the manufacturing space, for example, and IoT and the industrial Internet, and then that's, of course, coming out into the commercial space. So slide five, it just shows the exponential growth that we're seeing in connected devices. And really by 2020, you're talking about the number of things, not PCs, laptops, mobile phones, now exceeding all others, including our mobile phones. So the idea of machines going online and things talking to each other without much human intervention at all is really what we're dealing with. Slide six just talks about, this is the opportunity now, in terms of the estimated economic magnitude, what this means when you have this world of connected things, cyber-physical systems, and so on. Just the part, there's some economists that have done some analysis on the potential annual economic growth in U.S. dollars just on open data itself, okay? We're talking a range from $3.2 to $5.4 trillion of economic benefit. And then you look at the connected sensors by themselves, 2.7 to 6.2 trillion. And so really, even on the lower bounds, and even individually just on these trends, you're talking about trillions of dollars, much less the confluence of them and what may come out of that particular, the trends merging together and doing things. Slide seven then just shows some of the DAI opportunities. And really what we're talking about with data analytics innovation is what I call the elimination of the human gut, meaning the decision where we think we know something or we just do it because we have intuitive sense of things. And now that's moving away from sort of gut-based intuition-based decision-making. And now we're talking about database information decision-making. And it really is attacking inefficiencies in all aspects of life. So when you look at cities, for example, we're talking about utilities benchmarking, so you know where your energy is going and how much water you're consuming. You're talking about knowing where trains are, the subway in real time, for example, or the bus. And I have, for example, on my mobile phone, I have a free app that I can look at called Transit, and I can just look at it any time near me, where the next bus is coming, what time it's going to be there, the subway station, and so on. So it's brought a lot more information and allows me to move around more efficiently and to manage my expectations as a public transit consumer. Parking spots, finding those is another thing. Census, I heard there was a chief statistician in the room, be very familiar with the idea of all of the data now. But what's interesting here at our Census Bureau is I think the awakening to the fact that you still are always going to need statistics and things, but you're now in a world where computation is cheap and data is ubiquitous, and we can now posit a world where we might not have to do statistical modeling only on our census things. We can talk about doing all the data in a way that just hadn't been thought of before. Just in the same way that when you talk about Google, you can look across all the web in that way, in a manner that would not conceivable before that particular search engine came about. Social media is another example, and again, finding efficiencies in that. When you move on to, in our study, we looked at several sectors. We looked at healthcare, transportation, and the financial market space. But on slide eight, really are just looking at what this looks like pictorially here in the U.S., the sources of health data, and just you, the patient, in the upper right of the triangle of the slide, you, the patient, are in the orange bullet, and you have the various actors, the physician or the hospital, the insurer, the payer, and then various blue dots are things where information may flow, for example, to your pharmacy or something like that. But that was then, and this is now, in 2013, and then a lot of healthcare changes here in the United States. You're talking about a mesh of information there, and that's both, again, opportunity to find efficiencies, but also it has risk in terms of your personal information going out there and having your health information kept private to you. So again, opportunity and yet challenge at the same time. When you look at slide 9, we're talking about connected and devices used by consumers and patients, and now it's the merging of things and medical information that people can wear, like fitness trackers, and then they report oftentimes very publicly on things, as well as the kind of information that's kept private here in the U.S. And the confluence of those can be powerful, again, for improved or more efficient diagnostics and treatment, and yet it's risk to your health information leaking out. Just the healthcare savings alone is on slide 10. It's estimated, really, when you look out of various categories of healthcare, you're talking about billions of dollars annually in savings, be it on more efficient care, more value for the money, understanding your lifestyle changes so that you avoid the disease in the first place, so that you're told that you need to do better in your own personal life, for example, you can save a huge amount of money. So again, this is a tremendous opportunity for usually what's one of the largest sectors of expense, at least for the public sector here in the U.S., but I'm sure in other countries as well. Slide 11 is just looking at what now you can visualize in the financial market space. This is the credit default swap market, and it just is a picture of risk. You can see the net sellers and the large orange bubbles, and then you have much smaller net buyers. And so this is a picture or a microcosm, if you will, of what happened in the financial market implosion globally in 2007. So what big data does for you is allow you to see these things, and that can be beneficial to the regulator to help identify risk in markets so as to avoid those sort of events in the future. Turning to transportation on slide 12, this is just one slide. There's many others that you could talk about, but this is now the idea of instrumenting your car as part of the Internet of Things, and if cars are talking to each other or vehicle to vehicle, what we call V2V, then you can posit the idea of warning systems, improved safety, and so on, and yet at the same time, you're not in control of that information, and that may pose a threat to you or your perception of loss of privacy because you have data about your location or your vehicle and so on going out without your consent. So there's always an upside and a downside, but the issue with this is can we move from a need to know, like I need to give permission, to a responsibility to provide? If I can save a traffic accident and save lives, am I more obligated to the broader benefit than just my own desire to keep to myself? And then on slide 13, this is really getting into the challenges of data analytics innovation. There are, as with many technology trends, economic winners and losers. And so really this is an analysis looking at the kind of what's to come, what's expected by our economists in terms of AI impact. And there are some level of impact that's limited. For example, in the manual tasks with relatively low education required, there's certain things where it's not going to be a tremendous impact upon you, as in your job will still need folks to clean buildings and things, will still need flight attendants, will still need lots of services like that. However, you go to the middle layer when you're talking about routine tasks and medium education or the skills. You're talking about bookkeeping, you're talking about manufacturing. Here in the U.S., at least, there's been a tremendous amount of job loss in that particular sector in the Midwest of the country. And, of course, that had a large impact on our recent election as well. So we're seeing extensive and expected to continue in terms of that particular sector of working or workers. And then also extensive impact, although complementary, to the higher education, the professional white-collar class, typically, this is going to be a tool. It's going to help do the work. And so there's a benefit there on that end. But, of course, as in our economies, there's not as many of those folks. So the question is, where are the jobs? Then when you go to slide 14, you're talking about concerns of privacy. This is just a schematic of your mobile phone and where data actually goes and flows and so on. And it's really what's called the third-party usage that's the risk. How are these things How is your data being utilized? Have you given it permission? Is it opt-in or opt-out in terms of how you share? There are very different paradigms for that. So this is just a picture of what that looks like. And so just to conclude, just at a high level, and get right to discussion or questions, really, again, there's tremendous opportunity and challenges with the AI, again, as we see the rise of the Industrial Revolution and the new cyber-physical systems. It's the fourth Industrial Revolution, as the World Economic Forum calls it. And so I think, really, there's a tremendous benefit being realized, efficiency and effectiveness and so on, and that's going to continue. But the idea of a widening mismatch in jobs and what can be done, it does challenge the labor force as is. Can you retrain your labor force in time? That's a debatable point. The younger generation gets this and does this very well. The challenges for them is oftentimes there's not as many jobs for them. They're keen on using the technology, but there may not be the same kind of life expectancy that they can have that their parents did. And so that's just an economic challenge here in the States. And then lastly, there's just the idea of privacy and individual civil liberty on these. Again, if you know where your data goes, and of course the power of the AI is often the aggregation of data beyond your control, and things that might be known about you beyond your ability to stop that. I would note, for example, I read an article recently on the Chinese government has now a pilot they're running in cities on social capital. So they want to know if you're a person that doesn't like to pay their bills, or that, like, you know, throws trash out the window instead of putting it in the garbage can, or there are all kinds of indicators now beyond the typical credit scoring type things on do you pay your bills on time. You know, are you trustworthy with your money? It's now a social capital thing, and it's very Orwellian in that sense. And so that's the technology is sort of emerging there, and again, that's just a warning in terms of what's to come. So let me just pause there, and I'll go to slide 16. It just shows the cover of the recent report. All of this just comes out of this particular publication. It's fully downloadable. You're welcome to look at that. Welcome to stay in touch with you all again. But thank you for your time, and I'm happy to take your questions.
Thank you, Tim. Tim, this was is a report of the forum that took place, and which usually most of the reports, what you do with them, you are presenting them through the congressional channels. So what is happening with this report? For instance,
we reported on. Thanks for the question, Mia. So we worked for several committees on this project. It covered so many areas of interest. So, for example, our Judiciary Committee, they were concerned about the privacy, civil liberties dimensions of this. And on the U.S. House side of things, the House Science and Technology Committee, which was interested in the sort of the innovation and competitiveness angles on this. So we've reported out to them. They're interested in using these sort of things to help frame their legislative agenda. At times, reports like this might even be invited to come and serve as part of a giving official congressional testimony. And it often spawns or lays the framework for new work, for whether it's internal to GAO or other entities who want to do studies. So a broad impact on this. We've given the Congress a lot to think about on that. There is already a Senate caucus, for example, on the Internet of Things and other particular areas, competitiveness and manufacturing. And so they're taking this and seeing what they can do to, again, enhance this industrial revolution that we're walking into.
Okay. I mean, most of our systems are related, Congress is the parliamentary system, so probably what we're talking about is advice more or less within the parliament context, various committees, parliament context, that on the issue of data. And of course, the same preoccupation is taking place on the executive side, yeah? Or in our context, in the government chief scientist offices, as we discussed this morning. I think because there is a very comprehensive review in a very, very short time, and is an extremely good report. It's telling you, I'll make it available, I already was made available digitally because of Team, but it's extremely useful to try to understand even the language and the whole thinking about data, including the analytics. So should we pause a little bit and try to see how do we connect with what we discussed up to now? Omar, I'll pin you down because probably you are our typical science advisor. What would you ask Team? You pass on that data analytics at the moment. Okay, Alan?
I will probably come back later to that. I think this is really interesting, but there's probably going to be things that
Okay. Anybody at this point of time wants to, or you want to reflect? Okay, Alan?
Well, maybe just a question, because it was so intensive, the presentation, that some I didn't see, or maybe I didn't watch properly, but some key subjects like smart energy, smart cities, smart agriculture, etc., where the data revolution is also quite there. I mean, all this data is also going to improve smart cities, smart energy, smart... was this in the presentation? I'm not sure. A question.
So, how often do you think you hear that in your context? Datifying.
Right, so, yes, it's a great question. And some of this is the consumer is now getting the data for free.
Yeah.
Speaking personally, my utility here, they've instrumented our houses, like say for electricity, we have what are called the smart meters. And
yeah,
the primary reason for that is the utilities did not want to manually send a person to drive around and walk up to your house to read how much electricity you use during the billing period. They can just collect that remotely now and decrease costs and increase the incisiveness with which you can see where energy is being used. So what utilities are now doing is they're now making that data available to you. I can look at my own usage on something in real time from my mobile phone, and it's giving me real time information, allowing me to make decisions on, well, maybe I should do this to conserve energy and save money and so on. Mm-hmm. So in terms of just the general city thing, what I did not do, just for the brevity of time, there are some very powerful stories. My favorite example in the urban environment is what's going on in New York City. They have a whole, the New York University has a whole, NYU has a whole group looking at smart cities and cities as sort of data environments. So how they think about managing the taxi commission on certain busy times and so on, how they reroute traffic, how they better dispense social services, as well as security concerns and all kinds of issues that cities are I think, powerful and innovative laboratories of DAI. and are already doing tremendous things.
And obviously you mentioned the further developments that are taking place, where hence the analytics innovation, in particular in relation to artificial intelligence, and how far in the future are we looking into kind of the real application or integration of artificial intelligence in relation to these examples you mentioned? They're already there, yes. But...
Yeah, right. It's a great question, Mihail. I mean, in one sense, there's a now and not yet in AI.
Yes.
We're about to embark on a follow-on companion study to this on AI, because the question is well put. All of this essentially provides all the infrastructure for increasingly powerful artificial intelligence applications. But what we're seeing is already commercial mass market AI, you know, in the Apple universe or the Apple system, you have Siri, and Google, you have the Google Assistant, you have Amazon's Alexa on its various devices. So a lot of that has already come to us, and the future is now. When you look at where AI is going, I think you're seeing, again, increasing in digital manufacturing, for example, a lot of robotics, and they're increasingly becoming, I guess, more algorithmically intelligent. Mm-hmm. On the medical side, part of this particular study we saw was the usage of big data in the IBM Watson technology to help diagnosticians or the oncologists at one of our top cancer centers better understand when the patient presents. They can sort of, the algorithms can look at all the various amounts of information and just suggest to the physician, you know, to ask this question or look for this. Not certainly taking over the role of a decision maker, but certainly augmenting and helping them.
So there is
AI is going to have tremendous continued disruptive impacts.
And there is likely to be, therefore, a tremendous job.
Sure.
But a specific type of jobs, if you call them jobs, because I was, yeah.
Or even financial advising, for example. Yes. I didn't mention that one, but we have what are called so-called robo-advisors, and really... you're taking the humans out of the loop in just how you invest your money, and you're setting a risk tolerance. You're setting the amount of principal you're putting in, a risk tolerance, and your time horizon, and you let the algorithm, the AI algorithm, take off and manage your money for you without any human intervention.
Okay. Just one comment, and I will bring in, if you don't mind, Robert Hoffman from Ottawa, who had a meeting. And then John, but...
Michaela, can I just ask a question?
This is Mike.
It's Mike, yeah.
Mike, could yeah, quick, but then...
Well, it's a quick one.
Yes.
But, one of the things I've seen with all of this data is aggregation, and it's almost personal aggregation, isn't it? Because there seems to be a requirement... For aggregation of data, and you mentioned the situation about water and your water meters. And there's a personal view of that aggregation that is useful. And then there's a broader use of it for, you know, further analytics. So are you seeing a trend where people are able to use, say,
John?
Security or
Robert,
blockchain
this has a very short,
or whatever
very,
to
very short.
Allow, create an aggregated view of information, their own personal view, that they then allow others to use, if that makes sense. Because to me, if all this data is open and all the available, there are patterns that people can generate around this data that, you know, I personally wouldn't want people to know about. So how do you see people controlling the patterns, I suppose, is my question.
That's a great question, and it really goes to the heart of really the privacy, civil liberties type dimensions of this, because The fact of the matter is, we are just there is, in one sense, a large degree of loss of individual control of information about yourself.
Exactly.
When you look at the aggregation risk, there simply is no other way to avoid that. I think it's really mitigating that or understanding. I think here in the U.S., what will happen in time, and I suspect elsewhere, is just the concept of what privacy is will have to somewhat shift. I don't see, for example, our younger generation giving up their mobile phones.
The whole new think tanking.
I do think they're going to have, they're in for quite a shock when they understand or come to understand how little information that you can piece together can be very powerful in terms of the aggregation risk.
Okay.
And I think there's going to be potentially a backlash against that, but there's really no easy answer we're talking about entire new business models and social networking and things that are based upon about themselves and yet not understanding the aggregation risk that you rightly point out.
Okay.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So if you could stay online, team. We want Robert Hoffman for a few minutes to try to react, but also to bring in the issue of data and modeling for the in relation to the statistics, his experience in statistics in office in Canada. Robert. Good morning.
I'm pleased to have the opportunity to participate in this webinar because I think the subject of data is very important, particularly from the perspective of the formation of public policy. If public policy is to be evidence-based, then the importance of the availability of data is underlined. I should say a word or two about my background. I'm an economist by training. I worked in the Canadian Statistical Office for a period of 20 years, involved in sort of the research arm of the Statistical Office. And for the last 20 years, I have a small company that engages in systems modeling, mostly in the areas of energy and greenhouse gas emissions now, and in the whole issues of sustainability. I'm also a member of the Club of Rome, and I'm currently engaged in a project that's involved in new economic theory, it's called, that has been brought together by the World Academy of Art and Science. I would like to argue, I think, that we are, public policy is now being badly served by national statistical offices, particularly with respect to economic statistics. Essentially, what seems to have happened is that economic statistics are framed by mainstream neoclassical economic theory and macroeconomic theory that was addressing problems of economic stabilization that emerged in the, well, pre-war, and they were institutionalized in statistical offices in the immediate post-war years. And these frames have persisted, but these frames are unable to adequately serve the contemporary problems that I mentioned of sustainability and energy and climate and greenhouse gas emissions, et cetera. But we're attempting to try and do the analysis of these problems from data that comes from an inappropriate framing of the issues altogether.
So the data analytics, the analytics that Tim was referring to, and the innovation...
Well, I was quite fascinated by Tim's presentation because in it I didn't see much of a role being played by National Statistical Office. that in a sense, what's being said is that there's a tremendous amount of given modern technology of data that can be generated, and that data is being generated in response to particular issues. And one of the points that I would like to argue is that it is essential that the kinds of issues to be addressed and the collection and compilation of data need to be, in a way, fairly tightly coupled if they're to be appropriate. Statistical offices, as they grew up, have no mandate to get involved in public policy formation and the underlying analytics. They've been mandated to collect and produce certain statistics, and they do that now in a way that necessarily coupling between the analytics and modeling that are trying to address issues of public policy. That linkage has been broken.
So is a case of the current position of the Canadian Statistics Office, because we are given an example in the Commonwealth of the Canadian Statistics Office as being well ahead of others. But is a kind of...
Well, the work that I'm engaged in, which is to build a systems model capable of addressing issues of greenhouse gas emissions and energy systems, what I find is that the information compiled by the statistical office is really inadequate and to a degree inappropriate. To the extent that some of the government departments here that are engaged in these issues have had to implement their own data collection programs and data compilation programs, for the purpose of public policy analysis, and they of course have their own models. Problem in this is that we have data holdings in the hands of government departments who do not have a mandate to make it public.
Okay.
And so I think there is a need for institutions that bring together analytical tools that are designed to address particular problem domains and the process of data collection so that they're much more tightly linked.
Yes.
And the data collection programs can be tailored to be relevant.
Okay.
I'd like to quote Jay Forrester, who I think in the context of developing his national model way back when made the observation that 90% of the data that he needed to support the analysis was not there, and 90% of the data that was available publicly, mostly from statistical offices, was either redundant or irrelevant.
If you remind us, Jay Forrester.
This conundrum persists. Particularly in the domain of economic statistics, because for whatever reasons the science, if you want to call it that, of economics and economic theory is very much separate from the process of data collection and compilation.
Okay, so if you could pause a little bit, because John from the UK Statistics Office might be able to tell you what is happening right now here. Yeah? John, please. Tim, you are still online, yeah? Tim? Is Tim still online? Yeah.
Okay,
please go ahead, John.
So I think there's some really interesting issues that have been raised, but I'll just sort of say a little bit about where I come from our perspective. So
I said, better statistics, better decisions is this overarching theme. Within that, we also then see huge numbers of challenges. I very much recognise some of the criticism of the statistical system that many of the ways in which we collect statistics is based on how the economy used to be, not how the economy is today.
Yeah.
So in the UK, the only, well, around about 80% of the economic activity is services, yet that is not particularly well measured. Manufacturing is about 10 to 15% of the economy, yet that is extremely measured in a very detailed way. So there are many challenges we face. Also, the demands, because of all this extra data that Tim talked about, the demands on statisticians and on analysts is very, very high. People want more timely information. The idea that you would take 2 years to put together a set of statistics is no longer right. People want statistics very, very quickly. They also want to know about lots of detail. And certainly in the United Kingdom, people want to know about what is happening in a very local area. So these are very, very big changes, new demands coming along. But there are huge opportunities there. The sort of data sources Tim was talking about are potentially very, very valuable. They allow us to tap into sort of new insights, new ways of doing things. Data from mobile phones, from banking, those sorts of things, potentially very, very, very powerful in understanding flows of people. So many European countries are interested in what's going on with tourism and travel, and understanding how mobile phones are moving across borders, how many foreign mobile phones are operating in your country, helps you to understand those things. So there's lots of opportunities there to collect data in ways we've never done it in the past. But this is quite challenging. Statistics and statistical offices have tended in the past to operate on the basis of surveys. We've gone out and we've collected some data, often a very small number of respondents who we've then grossed up to be representative of the country as a country as a whole. So we had very small amounts of very, very precious data that we had to grow. Now we have so much data. The question is, which bits do we keep and which bits do we throw away?
And I think there is a role for statistical offices, certainly in the UK, a sense that people want... indeed, in some ways, profusion of information, profusion of data. People want a trusted source of information on different issues. And that's something that we try to be, that trusted source of information, whether it's on issues of migration, on issues of crime, on issues of the economy. So, for us, there's a huge amount of change coming along. The review by Professor Shelby talked about many of these challenges about how do we measure a very, very different economy to the one we might have had a couple of generations ago. But there are lots of new opportunities there. And as I said, for us, I think as a National Statistical Office, we want to make certain we are meeting the needs and really living up to, as I said, to that objective that we want better decisions to be made, that actually you need good statistics and good analysis and data to underpin that.
Mm-hmm. What about the issue of a mandate? I mean, does the mandate of the new emerging National Statistics Office in UK and probably all the others in the Commonwealth have got the same?
I think again that will some of these issues reflect the challenges and the political environment of particular
countries. No country is has an analogous situation. Mm-hmm. But as I said, in terms of where I think there is a distinction between where you are using data for service provision, so where you are using data to provide information on where parking spots are or on energy yeah. usage, provide those services, that's not a role for a National Statistical Office. But the role for us is where data can be used for statistics and research purposes. That is very, 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 very important. And we try not to get ourselves involved in data for those service delivery elements. I think they're very important. And before working for the National Statistical Office, I worked for the Revenue Department, Revenue and Customs Department here. And actually there, data is absolutely key to driving how you ensure tax compliance. There are a whole host of different issues there, but and again some privacy issues, ethical issues around how you do that. But as I said, at the moment, we're stuck much more on the other side of it in terms of how do we get the stats needed. It's statistics and research purposes for which we need the data. But many of those rich data sources can serve two purposes. They can both be used to drive the service delivery, but also then to improve our statistics.
The private sector is attempting to do the kind of function you might do? Or?
I think often you do find the private sector trying to do that. I think there are challenges around
data centers and data
So
science.
Sometimes you do see there are a number of organizations that want to try and sort of put statistics out there. Often they can be very useful, but they are often, again, it's back to the, do they have the sort of trusted status?
Yes, exactly.
And often, you know, they will not have, I mean, we have the benefits of the statistical infrastructure. We've talked about things like censuses. Business registers allow you to know the total universe of individuals and businesses and therefore how you might scale up your sample, where actually private sector providers don't have that. They are just saying, this is what the data says, but you don't often know if the data they're working with is representative.
How much is outsourced and how do you validate
it? So at the moment, a lot of our data collection is still very internal. And actually, one of the challenges we need to do is how do you then go and get in other data? But the key then is the validation is very different. So when you have a survey response, you can validate your survey responses by checking responses. You have to do very different things here. But this is the data quality issues that many other organisations are dealing with. So if we, you know, we want to take data from our revenue department to understand what's going on. And the issue there is about having a good conversation with the people who own the data so you understand its strengths and weaknesses. Administrative data is very, very powerful. I've used it a lot. But you need to understand its strengths and weaknesses. And there is no such thing as a perfect data set. Even survey data, we know people, certainly in the UK, underreport the amount they smoke and drink when you ask them. So we even know our surveys are not particularly perfect. Administrative data will also have some biases in it. The key thing is to understand those, and the best way of doing that is by talking to the people whose data it is. How is that data collected? When somebody is filling out a form, what do they think they're putting in a particular box? And that's the only sort of thing you can do is by having proper conversations with data.
Are people still filling forms or likely to fill forms? Because if you look at what Tim is saying is likely to happen.
Indeed, and we know certainly in the UK, and I think we see it across a number of countries, that people are much less willing to respond to surveys. So our main measure of employment and unemployment comes from something called the Labour Force Survey. And there we're only getting response rates of around 55%. We used to get responses around 80% of people responding. And increasingly, people are more reluctant to provide that information, and for a host of reasons. Yeah. So actually, these new data sources, as well as being an opportunity, in many ways, we also need to embrace them, because some of our previous ways of collecting data may no longer be there.
And this issue of, therefore, methods of surveys, statistical surveys, and vis-à-vis real-time type of data, which could provide with algorithms probably real-time analysis. Yeah. Anyway, these are just questions that marry the analytics.
I think the key thing sometimes is we know there will be some sources of, in some cases there will not be these new administrative or big data sources we can use, and we will still need surveys in some places. But the key question is to make certain we're only using surveys where there is no other alternative. Mm-hmm. And that's a really big mind shift for us.
And how are you regulated?
So in the UK, we are hopefully quite tightly regulated. So we produce the statistics, but there is a separate body that accredits those statistics. In fact, several of our statistics have lost that accreditation because they weren't deemed good enough, and we're in the process of trying to get those back. But I think a big important part of our approach, and again, maybe this is something where there's a difference between the private sector, is we are very open and transparent about our methods and our data. So you can understand exactly how we do, what our methodology is, and if people think that that's not a good methodology or we've not done it properly, then we welcome that challenge. But that transparency is just hugely, hugely important. And again, sometimes with some private sector providers are very, very good at being open, transparent. Others may be less so. But I think, again, that is part of that trustworthiness, that actually we have a community of users, academics and others who will provide that critique to us to keep us on the straight and narrow.
John, and a final question, because we talked about data scientists, and we are STEAM, you are online. Do you have many data scientists, and how do you deal with them? Because,
well, in many ways, I don't see...
Data analysts.
Yeah, I don't see a huge distinction between data scientists and many of our statisticians or economists that we have. Often the skill sets are very, very similar. And particularly with the younger generation, they come out of university with a lot of the, what you might say, are the data science skills. They have the ability to work with large data sets, pick up new programming languages quite quickly, very adaptable to ways of doing it. So for me, sometimes that distinction between data scientists and traditional statisticians is slightly overblown. Uh-huh. Is in many ways, it's about, not necessarily about skills, but mindset and how you go about solving a problem, which I think is... the data scientist starts from the, I've got this data, what does it tell me? Mm-hmm. The statistician often starts from, what's the question I want to know and how do I design the survey to get there? Mm-hmm. And actually, so it's not really about skill, it's more about the mindset and about how you approach a problem.
So in fact, probably the data scientist supporting the statistician,
yes,
so to speak.
Yeah.
Okay, I think, I don't know, Tim probably, we don't know if he's still online, but one other remark from here, so that quick, Omar, please.
Well, I mean, what I was trying to say was that we talked about, I think Tim talked about data tsunami, because of that unit analytics. But the tsunami is actually coming from and going into data collection, which is nothing to do with government, right? The thing that you get from your handphone, from your credit cards, and all that goes to companies, and they make use of it. So that does not help in policy making. Yes, and the policy making is still now dependent on statistical organization. And what you are saying is still you are doing survey, so that does not come into the big data kind of situation. So how do you reconcile this?
We know, and as I said, I think actually the UK in some ways is actually behind many other countries on this. And again, this is, for example, where Canada is very much a leader. I think there are different sorts of data. So our first area of sort of new data would be administrative data from, say, revenue departments or customs departments. So that would be the first thing where we do that. But actually, I think that you're absolutely right. A lot of the other data, mobile phones, goes to companies, or the financial data that Tim was talking about is really very potentially very powerful. But actually, if you have a conversation with, and we've started to do that with a number of companies, to say, well, actually, your data is very valuable. But if you shared it with us in a partnership way, we can get better statistics. Yeah. And if we've got a better description of the economy, that should help you create business opportunities and help running the economy. So I think you can have that conversation, but it does take a long while to get there. This is a very long-term picture.
For me, this raises the issue, how to improve the sharing. And so, is there a suggestion coming from you with experience? How do you organize or set up a governance structure to make this happen?
I think it's firstly
you need very, very clear policies about how data is going to be used. So we have policies that if data is shared with us, it won't be sent to anybody else. So we're absolutely clear about that, and we have policies and standards we aspire to. And actually, we are. If I was to go back and to share data unlawfully, I could be prosecuted and sent to prison for 2 years. There are laws that govern how we work that should give people you do that.
And standards.
standards, exactly. But then the key thing is then to build the relationships with the other organisations and to explain why you need the data. Because it's very important that they're bought into providing you with the data. And as I said, helping you to understand the strengths and weaknesses of the data. Because if they just sent you a DVD with the data on, you don't know the quality of it. You need them to really work with you on those sorts of things. So it is about getting your standards and policies right and then having honest and open conversations with the people who might be providing you with the data.
Yeah. No, but this is the governors. The governors were here, central bank governors, and Charles was here, David Hand were here in July. We're trying to bring you, but we didn't try hard enough. We had standards and statistics offices, and it was very difficult to not see that these central bank governor from Uganda, together with the statistics from Uganda, said that they do need to work closely, and doesn't matter about mandates. Until the mandates will come, we need to work closely. So there are national frameworks, so to speak, that are emerging.
The thing that we can have is to say that this relationship that needs to be established must be based on what smart we have been promoting, which is
smart management. No, indeed. It must be about, I think that's a very good, you can have all the laws and legislation you need, but if it's going to work, it has to work through the basis of both sides understanding.
Because I understood you to say that individual government departments may have statistics different from yours, which have no validation. Yeah. So they may be using them, but not able to say what they're using.
Yeah.
And you may suspect that their qualifications are based on nonsense, but you can't prove it.
Well, we have not quite my
responsibility, but the regulatory function does have the ability in the UK to ask. And criticise politicians if they are not being open about what data they are using and if it's published data. We have a very, again, it's if a politician is going to use data or statistics in public, it's, you know, we have a very strong assumption that that data should be absolutely transparent. Now, sometimes it's transparent, but it's not a particularly good quality, but at least... you're not going to ask me to comment on current politicians.
I think really a team probably had to go. I don't know if Tim is online, but we thank to him very much, and so was Robert. We tried to fit in
as a final roundup of the discussion since yesterday morning. And I suppose it couldn't have been better than you to try to round up the discussions of data and the immediate connection with data for everybody, with statistics. We did talk about central bank governors. We did talk about a Bureau of Standards and data and science advice and data. And I was just wondering if... it is probably the moment when, in about 5 minutes or so, we should probably round up the think tanking that started yesterday on leveraging data, value of data, and smart partnership, or the smart partnership way. And we had in mind to also relate to kind of data and global and national security a bit more than we did yesterday. But of course, each and every of the topics we discuss about it relates to national security broadly defined, that is food security or data security. Or and we've seen from Tim that there are analytics available and emerging for that purpose. So I would like anybody to... Who would like to say just final reflections, final thoughts about where we are going from now on. I mean, one of the things that emerged this morning from Alan was that, okay, data and visioning.
Well,
Alan.
Just 2 minutes, maybe.
Yes.
Because we've been exchanging a lot during these 2 days. So
yeah.
What I take is that Well, first, the tsunami of that data. Okay, so we're all,
can you
all
put
all
a last?
The tsunami. Then, different types of data. You have scientific, technical, social, commercial, economic, security, and all these are categories that all face a tsunami. Now, in the SMART partnership, we are interested by the shaping and the implementation of national visions. So we have tried to relate this data tsunami to the shaping of public policies and national visions. We have seen that, and another thing we didn't touch very much, but you touched a bit on it when you talked about public-private partnerships on data, it's the subject of open data, because the opening of public data to be used by anybody is a subject even for European directives. So it is a very topical issue for governments, is how much do they release of the data that they capture from the general public. So all these issues are very, very topical and put some weight on the national bureaus or offices for statistics. Now, the issue of standards, we did touch on that, and we did say that we need international standards because data is exchanged internationally, and it's a question of capturing, coding, exchanging, interoperating data, managing data in a secure way with IT, etc. So we did mention the work at the international level between ISO and IEC. I commend to your attention some reports that have been made by these two organizations on international standards and big data, international standards and the Internet of Things, international standards and cloud computing. So you can find all this information on the sites of these organizations. Also, the International Telecom Union has also produced a report on big data. So we have made the connection during these 2 days that standards are technicalities, but they are very important in order to exchange and secure the exchange of data. So it's been a very rich interaction, at least from my point of view. So I thank all the speakers.
In a way, Alan was very rich, but in fact was only about one thing. He's trying to say what is data, what is the value of data, and how one can leverage. Now, Silas, at the beginning you asked, what is data and what is... Now, we are at the end of this marathon of data and various sectors. Are you able to go back home to tell Prime Minister simple? Because I think the only way the Prime Minister will understand that is if you say your National Statistics Office in Lesotho or the department may need to get involved into understanding the value of data. That's the immediate thing. If you say a bit more standard statistics and all that, is probably going, and particular visioning, is probably any prime minister will be a bit worried about this free data available everywhere. Please.
Yes, I actually learned a lot about the data, statistics, and all of the data and the types of the data that we can use. And I was more interested on the use of data for the planning and development of programs. So that is where my basis is. So I think I have learned a lot about that, because I have realized that there is nothing that we can plan and implement without tapping to data. We need data, we need even statistics in order to plan well for the development of our...
Sorry, are you avoiding the answer? Would you be able to make a brief?
Of course, yes.
About the value of data and delivery.
The value of data, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Fine, I mean, that's what probably we're trying to do, actually, to try to ensure that everybody is able to go back home and in Swaziland or in Zimbabwe or in Botswana or in Uganda to be able to alert
And you can't just talk about data unless you talk about specific, right, about statistics or this or that or the other. And that was the purpose of the exercise. As far as the way forward is concerned, from the CPTM point of view, the networks probably and the associated with various activities, including data and statistics, will be taking over the issue of leveraging data in their own context. So with this, I would like to thank all those that are on. We need to finish, in fact, we should have finished about 5 minutes ago, because we are going to have to start the formal business in about 5 minutes to three, to be ready to start the formal business of the CPTM Limited. And I will have to close, actually, and thank everybody. Could you thank later, George?
Right now.
Okay, fine.
Well, I've been appointed by some good friends, but I am sure that I express the feelings of everybody for a vote of thanks.
A set of meetings with webinar and think tanking sessions, very interesting sessions, challenging and provoking and informative. Thank the specialists that you managed to bring along and for your special contribution. We'd like to thank the staff of the hub for their the hospitality and for making our life comfortable here. Like to thank the people taking minutes, and I'm sure that they would be available on the internet. And thank Jonathan and Joseph and his team for organizing such an efficient system here. Right. So we don't have a glass of wine to thank you, but we do it the usual way.
Thanks for the